today's session. Today we would be discussing the remaining five theories on mountain building. In the past class, we have already talked about the two major theory, that's the Kober theory and the plate tectonics theory. Now we would be referring to the other major theories on mountain building in this class, and at last we will try to do a comparative analysis of all the five theories that we would be discussing today. So let's start with the first theory, that is the Jeffrey's theory. Now Jeffrey talked about the concept of thermal contraction. So there were few main elements that Jeffrey talked about. So when he was trying to explain the concept of mountain building, he said there are layers in which earth is arranged. So the innermost layer, which is very hot, has a force that acts outward, or it's trying to move out in comparison to the outermost layer, which gets rapidly cooled due to the atmosphere here. And when it is cooled, when cooling takes place, what is happening is there is a kind of difference in the cooling. So outermost layer, I can say, is fully cooled. In comparison to that, the inner layer is not that much cool. So there is a gap that is created between the two layers, and this gap leads to kind of compressive force or crumbling down and folding, which results in mountain building. He also tried to explain an interesting concept which was known as level of no strain. So level of no strain is an area that is well supported from below, and also it can freely contract. So it's a kind of region which lies between the inner area and the outermost area, which cannot fall below, or which is well supported from below, and also it has the ability to contract. So these are the few things that he tried to focus on. So he said the outermost layer, which is cooled, gets contracted, and when it contracts, it crumbles down, which leads to thinning and lateral formations. Then he talked about another concept, that was cooling of the ocean in comparison to continents. So he said you have continents here and ocean here. So cooling of ocean occurs at much faster pace as compared to continents. As a result, you have formation of mountains along the continental margins. Because of this concept, he could explain the north-south extent of mountains. So he explained the origin of Andes and Rockies along the coast of North America and South America based on this concept. Now what is interesting to note here is that under Jeffrey's thermal contraction theory, he was able to explain the north-south extent of mountain, while what we have previously read under the Kober's theory, he was able to explain the east-west extension of mountains like Himalayan range and Alps. So now it's important to note that theory would become the most acceptable theory which could explain both the east-west expansion and the north-south expansion, because across the globe we can see we have mountains that run north to south as well as east to west. So this was the very first theory and the basic essence of the theory that we have talked about. Now there were a lot of criticism that Jeffrey faced. First and the foremost criticism that came across for the Jeffrey's theory was, if we look into the present day mountains, you have remnants of fossils that could be found in the mountains. If these remnants of fossils are there, that means these have an origin from sea, but that was not explained under Jeffrey's theory. That's the first criticism. The next criticism is, he talked about constant interval for the occurrence of for the thermal contraction to occur. That was another criticism that was faced by Jeffrey. He also underestimated the aerial composition of the rocks, and also there was he could not explain the origin based on the convection current. So these were some of the drawbacks that Jeffrey faced. The next theory that came up was of Jolly. Jolly focused on radioactive theory. Now, it's important to note that both Jolly and Holmes focused on radioactive elements, but there was a minor difference, I should say, between the two theories. Jolly focused on the radioactive elements from inside the earth, and he said that these radioactive elements lead to melting and resolidification. This melting and resolidification gives rise to mountain building. In contrast to that, Holmes talked about convective currents that originate due to the radioactive element that occurs beneath the sea. So what we are trying to understand here under Jolly's theory is, he said you have continents as well as oceans. So he tried to explain that the density of continent is less as compared to the density of oceans. Continent is mainly made of sea in comparison to ocean crust, which is made of sima. So when he talked about this concept, he said that continents below them have huge radioactive deposits in contrast to ocean. Now, since they have huge radioactive elements that occur beneath the continents, what happens is the radioactive processes and kind of melting that occurs here is much more pronounced, but this takes years and years for the process to take place. As a result, what happens is the continents have a much higher cooling of the surface layer in contrast to the ocean. So he said the activity under ocean was much more pronounced in compared to continents, despite of the fact that continents have much higher radioactive elements below them. So he said there is no heat transfer that takes place from sima to CR, but still what is happening is there is accumulation below the ocean crust. So he talked about retention of heat below the ocean, that is sima, and that is due to the radioactive activity as well as lack of thermal gradient in the lower layers of the ocean, and also the difference of the thermal gradient between sima and the ocean and the continent. Now he talked about two phases that are most popularly discussed. One was the melting and the other was the resolidification. So under the melting stage, he talked about the transgressional seas. So what happens during melting is the melting of the substratum that produces pressure, and that pressure leads to expansion. Because of that expansion, what happens is the oceans increase, and we call this phase, and Jolly called this phase as transgressional seas. In contrast to that, during resolidification, what happens is there is maximum contraction, and when there is contraction, you have the folds that come up, and due to the folding, you have uprising of the continents during the phase of resolidification. This leads to formation of mountains, and this phase is known as regressional phase. In contrast to this, where melting is prominent, this was termed as the transgressional phase. Now, Jolly's theory was one of the most widely accepted theory for a while, but it also suffered numerous drawbacks. The first and the foremost drawback that it suffered was the concept of the 30 kilometer thickness that it talked about for the Sial. So it said that the Sial is just 30 kilometers wide, and this was established as an invalid fact by numerous later geographers that came up. The next thing on which Jolly was criticized was Jolly talked about a kind of stable earth, but in reality there is continental drifting and plate tectonics that are active, and those were included by the next person, Holmes, who applied the same concept of radioactive element, but he also included the phenomena of convection currents or convective currents. The next drawback that he said was, he talked about equally spaced intervals, which in reality do not take place. So he talked about equally spaced intervals for mountain building process. And finally, some of the scholars criticized Jolly based on the fact that radioactivity itself is not a sufficient condition for mountain building. So as a result of criticism and a lot of arguments that it faced, the next person that talked about mountain building and has been read popularly is Holmes. So as we mentioned previously, he talked about thermal convection currents. According to Holmes, the interior of the earth has huge lot of energy. That huge lot of energy or heat within the interior of the earth is released. So you have radioactivity, the radioactive, and this radioactivity also leads to convective currents. That's the first thing to understand. The second thing he talked about, the tidal force and friction, which are responsible for continental drifting. Now, when we would be covering Holmes' theory, we would be covering his two concepts and his three stages. So, the first concept he talked about was, when we talk about Earth as a whole, he said, under equator, you have the convective currents that move up, and these convective currents submerge at the poles. So that's the first thing he talked about. The next thing he talked about was the continent have much higher convective forces as compared to ocean. The next thing in line to this concept, he explained that if there is just a continental surface, what would happen is you would have convective current that would rise and there would be drifting away of the current. As a result, there would be tensional force applied here, and this tensional force would lead to continental drifting. In contrast to that, he explained the region where there is ocean and continental margin. At the region of ocean and continental margin, he said there would be subsidence, and when there would be subsidence of convective currents, there would be crumbling of the existing strata, and when this existing strata would crumble up, there would be origin of mountains. So because of that, he could explain the origin of mountains along the continental and ocean line. So he could very well explain the origin of Rockies and Andes, which run again north-south, because of this concept. Now that was one thing that he talked about. The next thing that he talked about was the various stages involved in the mountain building process. So to explain this, he broke his concept into three major stages, and these stages are considered at par to the Kober's stage. So similar to the lithogenesis, orogenesis and glyptogenesis that were given by Kober, Holmes also explained three stages. Under the first stage, there are weak convective currents that go up and they kind of diverge. These lead to formation of geosynclines. So these were considered as weak currents. During the process, or the stage 2, he explained intense or huge convective currents, and these convective currents led to folding and crumbling of mountains, which resulted in the real process of mountain building. And finally, in the last stage, there was waning of the convective currents, And this stage was considered at par with the gliptogenesis stage that was explained by Kober. Now, Holmes' theory became one of the most popular theories. But again, the major criticism that Holmes faced was convective currents and the interior heat, in the inner heat of the earth itself is not sufficient to explain the process of mountain building. And this process was argued on numerous terms, because of which a lot of elements of which were included into the concept of explaining the origin of mountains by continental drift. So here, as you can see, this diagram shows how the convective currents move, and this is towards the island arc, and this is the main mid-oceanic ridge that is being formed. So the next theory that came up for mountain building was given by Wegener. Now, Wegener also talked about the concept of continental drift. Now, if we go back to the concept of continental drift, what he explained was, there is a huge landmass which is known as Pangaea, and that is surrounded by a set of water body that is known as Penthalsa. This Pangaea, which is Sial, floats on this Penthalsa, that is the oceanic layer or made up of sima. Now, slowly and gradually, there were two forces that acted on this Pangaea. The first force was the tidal force, and this force tried to drift the land towards the west, and the second was the force of gravity that tried to push it southwards or towards the equator. Now, these two forces predominantly were explained under the continental drift theory. What Wegener tried to explain was, due to these two forces, what is happening is, there are the two forces that are acting in the Pangaea, and these forces are resisted by the outer sima or the outer ocean. As a result, there is crumbling and folding, and this crumbling and folding leads to formation of mountain building. So this theory could explain both the north-south origin or the north-south stretch of mountain ranges, which was due to the westward flow or westward drift. And secondly, it could also explain the east-west mountain ranges like Himalayas and Alps due to the southward movement towards the equator. So this theory could again both explain the north-south movement as well as the east-west movement. But the important thing to note here was, under Wegener's theory, what was happening was, there was indeed the pressure that was put by sima on the Sial, and there was crumbling of the mountain ranges, but he could also explain the concept of origin of island arcs. And according to him, the island arcs that originated was due to the difference in the rate of drifting. So, the rate of drifting of the continents differed, and this differential rate of drifting led to formation of island arcs. Now, despite of the concepts that were laid forward by Wegener, Wegener also faced a lot of criticism. The first criticism was, tidal force is not a sufficient force to explain mountain building. If the tidal force was that strong to explain the mountain building, why it was only few of the geographers who applied the concept of tidal force? That was one of the major criticism that was faced by Wegener's theory. And another criticism was that the resistance of sima is not that high as it is considered by Wegener. Now, another theory that we would be discussing is the continental sliding theory given by Daly. Now, this theory is kind of opposition to the basic concept of isostasy. Still, we would be covering this theory because this theory has been considered as an important fact in understanding the process of mountain building. So, what Daly talked about was, he tried to divide Earth into three domes. He called this region as North Dome. He covered the central region as Equatorial Dome. and the lowermost region as south dome or the southern dome. Between these three domes, he considered that there is water body, and he called it as south mid-latitude furrow or Pacific, and this as north mid-latitude furrow or Tethys Sea. This theory also accounted for huge amount of ocean in comparison to landmass. The another interesting fact that this theory laid forward was that Sial is heavier than Sima, or the continent is heavier than the oceanic crust. Now this was a kind of opposition to what we have studied under the concept of isostasy. So he considered the Sial as glassy basalt, as made up of glassy basalt, and this glassy basalt is much more heavier than the Sima. And what he talked about was the breakdown or the collapse of glassy basalt, and the region where there was the breakdown, this led to formation of mountain ranges here. So that was the first and the foremost critic that Daly faced, that he considered Sial or the crust to be heavier than the substratum. That is not the reality or not the case. So his assumption of the model itself was incorrect, and because of which he faced a lot of criticism. He also said that you have huge water bodies that exist between these three domes, and these water bodies were the geosynclines, which was exactly not the case, because if this was the only geosyncline, all mountains that would have come up should be in this range only. So these were the major criticism that was faced by Daly. Now we have covered the basic aspect and the essence of the five theories that we have covered. So he talked about this glassy basalt and breakdown of this glassy basalt here. So now we come on to a comparative analysis of the five theories that we have discussed today. So the first one is the Jeffries. We call it the thermal contraction theory. This thermal contraction theory, the main orogenetic force behind this theory was gradual cooling of the earth. And he talked about the gradient in the cooling, concept of level of no strain. Then he talked about cooling of oceans at a faster pace as compared to landmass, and the origin of north-south mountains. The next was the Joly's theory. Joly talked about the radioactive theory for mountain building. He explained that radioactivity or inner heat is the only cause or the only orogenetic force that led to mountain building, which was one of the basic criticism of this theory. He focused on melting and resolidification. And he also talked about the tidal force and the force of friction which led to drifting. The tidal force and the force of friction. So he explained that melting leads to transgressional seas, and resolidification causes contraction and uprising of the mountains, which was a part of regressional sea phase. The next was Daly's theory. That was the continental sliding theory. The only force that he considered was the force of gravity. He talked about collapse of earth, the crust, and that was due to the weight of the oceanic water and the geosynclines and the forces of gravity that are acting on it. The next theory was the convective current theory given by Holmes. He talked about indeed the radioactivity that comes out as a result of inner heat, but he also considered convection currents or the convective currents within the earth as an important force that led to formation of mountain building, and these convective currents led to crustal thickening and uneven distribution of the ranges. And finally you have the Wegener's theory, that's the continental drift theory. His main forces that he considered was the gravitational force which pushes it towards the equator, and the tidal force which pushes it westwards, And he finally talked about crumbling of the continental margins because of this reason. So with this we cover the major five theories in mountain building. We would be covering further sessions in geomorphology in the further classes. You can subscribe to ExamRace channel for any further update. Stay tuned. Have a good day.